ends, man. It's just, I'm tired and I need to rest, but I'm just like so quiet and alive. I'll be walking around.
And far be it from me to not believe. Even when my eyes can't see.
They went for a little bit.
And this mountain that's in front of me.
I'm going national. You want to use this when you,
the midst of the sea.
You can just swing it through.
Good evening. Great to see everybody here tonight at Memorial Heights Baptist Church. You know, we've really appreciated Chuck and Amber's ministry and music, and Lord willing, we're going to be getting them plugged in more on Sunday mornings. But it's great to have Andy back with us tonight after his summer of ministry at camp. And so we're going to start with a sort of a hymn medley, sort of. It's two songs a medley. So I'm going to ask you guys, as we begin tonight, with a word of prayer. To stand up, we're going to pray, and then we're going to sing a song. I want you guys to clap along while we sing, all right? Would you stand? Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to gather together as brothers and sisters in Christ. May you be honored by all that we say and do tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, now if you clap, I want you to clap with me, not against me, all right? Don't y'all clap like Baptists. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I ain't giving up yet. Here we go. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like a blind man, I wandered alone. Worries I claim for my own. Then like the blind man that God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. With me, not against me. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy. Sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. When death takes me down and I breathe in no more, will sound on that eternal shore. When I join with the angels in heaven on high, singing praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I'll fly away, oh glory. By and by, I'll fly away. Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a land on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. By and by, I'll away. When the shadows of this life have gone, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars has flown, high away. Shall never end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by. I'll fly away. One day closer, amen? Amen. You may be seated. Pastor Nick.
All right. Handful of announcements. Sit this down. We're running out of room on this. On Wednesday, we voted, if you were here this morning, this certainly deserves a round of applause. We're excited to have Elmer as our newest deacon. On our leadership team. He was voted in unanimously this past Wednesday, and we will be having an installation service in September, this coming month. Also, Saturday, Heart for Missions here at the church, 10 a.m. Please bring your missionary magazine. If you want more information about that, you can talk to Rhonda Humbertson right after the service. Also, next Sunday, we have a lot going on next Sunday. We have a new security system going into place for our children's ministry. So if you don't know what that's all about, we had a meeting, talk to somebody that's involved in the children's ministry, or catch me, and I can let you know what's going on with that. We also have new classes for our Sunday morning Bible study starting up. We're adding a children's class, adding a college and career class, and we still need a helper for the toddlers. So if you're interested in that, see Elmer or myself, and I'll point you to Elmer. To get you involved, yeah, it's all in Elmer. Children's Church is going to be starting ages 5 to 8 rather than 5 to 9 for the entirety of the service, though. So we'll have some worship songs over there for the kids, and they'll be a part of Children's Church from the beginning to the end. And the service, it says, will be shortened. Also, no evening service next Sunday night. September 18th, we will be taking the youth on a trip to the Bible Museum in D.C., If you're interested in that, reach out to me, kids, or if you're watching online, can't be here tonight, kids, just reach out to me and I'll get you more details about that, what it'll cost, what the times will be, and all of that coming up. September 21st, Senior Supper, 5 p.m. On the menu for the night, beef stew, and Jim Jeffries will be speaking at that. Also in September, September 22nd, Awana will be starting up. Praise that we're able to do that. And certainly want to start lifting that up in prayer now, because that's a huge outreach for our church. September 26th, church picnic, 4 to 7. Please sign up on the sign-up sheet in the hallway, the number of people coming, what you're bringing, and for those who are able, please plan on helping at 7 with cleanup. That's a super important part of the evening, so please help if you can. Prayer requests, Jim Zoller. Phil Duncan, a friend of Pastor DJ, who is still hospitalized and in critical condition with COVID. We want to continue lifting up Bob McCullough, Heather Fields, Peggy Williams, who's recovering from surgery, Carolyn and Don Bolger. Don's still in the hospital. Sherry Stump with upcoming surgeries. Butch Simpson with an upcoming knee replacement. Butch Jenkins with his back. Connie Hauser, who has an upcoming surgery, as well as many others who are sick and have lost loved ones during this time. And we also just want to continue lifting up our nation. And we know that our nation certainly needs prayer, as well as our fellow believers around the world and those who are in Afghanistan who are trying to flee right now. So let's go to the Lord in prayer for all these requests, as well as just the service tonight. Lord God, we thank you for another evening that we can gather together and worship you. Lord, we thank you for the freedom that we have to be able to do that. Lord, we lift up our brothers and sisters around the world who are unable to freely worship you, or who, if they do freely worship you, Lord, will be persecuted for that faith. Lord, I just pray for the protection of our military as they're serving, trying to evacuate dangerous areas right now. And Lord, I just lift up this service to you as well tonight. I pray that all would be said and done for your glory. You know what each of these requests need, whether that's peace, healing, comfort. Lord, you are the provider of all those things, and Lord, we trust you with them. Lord, we love you, we praise you for what you're going to do tonight, and we ask that you open our hearts to your word so that we might learn through it and be a better servant to you on our daily lives. Lord, we love you, we praise you, we ask this in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Nick. Y'all can remain seated, but sing out with us as we worship the Lord. In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore. I won't fear what tomorrow brings. With each morning I'll rise and sing. My God's love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore. Fire before us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storms. Fire before us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storms. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore. Jesus, in your name we pray. Come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us something to live for you and glorify your name. Your nothing has the power to save but your name is a strong and mighty. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nation sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power. Nothing has the power to save but your name.
Father, we do come to you now in the name of Jesus. It's only through Jesus and by your Spirit that we're able to call you Father, that we're able to come to you in prayer. And God, as we see all that's going on in the world around us, not only in the nations of the world, God, but even in the states of our own country, God, and we see the chaos and confusion and the fear, God, may we be reminded as your church that we have the only message that can save, and that's the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Father, may we be more and more faithful to preach it. May we be more and more faithful to live it out. And God, may we be more and more faithful, God, when we see darkness and see things that, God, in the flesh terrify us, God, to run to the strong tower that is your name, and to remember the promise that you will never leave us or forsake us. And so, God, we do pray again in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 6. We know the world can be a dangerous place. I don't think you'd find too many people that would argue with that. But let me remind you that the world is also full of hidden dangers. I want to show you a picture from, I believe, Suffolk, England, if I'm not mistaken. This is a small fishing hamlet in Suffolk. And it's a serene picture at first glance. But do you notice the circular pattern in the grass there? That is what is left of a landmine. Because 80 years ago, though once a peaceful fishing hamlet, nearly 80 years ago, Suffolk, England was in danger of invasion by the Nazis. And so in this peaceful village, there were mines that were placed to alert the people in case there was a sneak attack or a sneak invasion. And now what you're seeing is the crater of a mine that had been detonated in the era of World War II. There are hidden dangers. This world is a minefield, friend. It is a minefield. And all there are certain dangers that we know to look out for, but there are many other dangers that lurk beneath the surface and beneath the surface. And when Jesus says, you need to walk with me and you need to follow me, and my word needs to be the lamp unto your feet, and my word needs to be the light unto your path, you had better believe that if you stray too far, all there is forgiveness. But remember what we said last week. Grace, while it does remove condemnation, it does not remove all the consequences of the choices that we make. And so we come to the Lord in prayer tonight as we wrap up this short study on what often is called the Lord's Prayer, what is really more correctly called the disciples' prayer. And we're going to focus in on faith in conflict. Now, as we have approached this important message, remember in Luke we have the same teaching, and one of the disciples came to Jesus and said, Lord, teach us to pray. And Jesus said, here's how you need to pray. He's not just saying, here's what you need to pray. He's not saying that you're to chant this in some type of liturgical way so that you're not thinking about what you're saying. This is the way that we're to pray. This is how we are to approach God. And so we started a few weeks ago looking at how we approach God. Let's, for sake of context, jump into chapter 6, verse 5. When thou prayest, Jesus said, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to the Father which is in secret. And thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. But when ye pray, use not vain repetitions, as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask him. After this manner therefore pray ye, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, or from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. For if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if ye forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Now, very quickly, we saw 2 weeks ago how we should approach God in prayer. And we said that we need to approach God correctly. Don't approach God as the hypocrites do, thinking that they'll be seen for their many loquacious verbiage and sayings, that they make such a show of their prayers. Don't think that God is impressed with any of that. Don't approach God as a heathen priest, thinking that you'll be heard for your many words or just vain repetitions, taking a phrase and repeating it over and over and over again until you put yourself into some kind of self-hypnosis. That's how the pagans do it. That's not how disciples of Jesus are commanded. We are instead to approach God intimately. We're to approach God as his child with the intimate access of a child, but also worshipfully, with reverence for his name. And as we saw, that's a reference to the Trinity, to the triune God. We also then, because we're his children, when we approach him with reverence, we approach confidently. We pray kingdom prayers. We don't start with, God, here's what I want. We profess and remind ourselves of the truth that his kingdom is coming. And that is an essential perspective that we have when we pray, because it reminds us that all of the trials that we face in this world are temporary. And it reminds us that victory in Jesus Christ is certain. And thy will be done. We are praying submissively, seeking to build God's kingdom in our prayers, not just build our own. And so we approach God submissively. We start with submission, not petition. Disciples do not pray to get their own way. We pray to be part of what God is doing and to see God move and to see God be glorified. And those are the prayers that God will answer. And so last week we began talking about the four pleas of the disciple. We talked about faith in tension. Provision. Give us this day our daily bread. That's what we need for today. Absolution. Healing in our relationships. Forgive us as we forgive. If God is my Father, and He is my Father, because there was a day when I was a child when I recognized that I was a sinner, that I was under condemnation because of my sin. Oh, I hadn't killed anybody, but I had stolen things. I knew as a child I had lied to my parents. I knew as a child that I had rebelled against God and broken God's laws. And I understood as a child that I was under condemnation and that apart from an act of God's grace, I was bound for hell. But because God so loved the world, He sent Jesus Christ to die for my sin. And then He rose Jesus from the dead, proving that Jesus gave the perfect sinless sacrifice. Because He is not just man, He is God, a very God. And I was, as a child, forgiven of my sin, brought into the family of God, saved forever by His grace through faith. And so, God is my Father. But as I learned early as a child, and as I am learning now as a father, that there's the relationship that doesn't end, but there's also the relationship that can experience tension when there's disobedience. And times when I disobeyed my dad, as few as those times were. More than he knew, actually. I got away with more than I should have. I don't get away with anything with God, my Heavenly Father, though. And so when I disrespect Him, when I disobey Him, friend, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That relationship is restored with our Heavenly Father. But then because God has forgiven us, He expects us to forgive each other. And that's the healing in the relationships around us. And so as we have seen here in these very red words that Jesus has spoken to us, if ye forgive not men their trespasses. When there's conflict between my sister and I, that creates conflict between my parents and I. Between my parents and me. So if I want that to be right, I need to make this right. And the same is true in the spiritual family. If you expect to have a healthy communication with your Heavenly Father, you need to make sure that you're forgiving your brothers and sisters when they do wrong to you. And we talked a little bit last week about what forgiveness is and what it isn't. I'm not going to re-preach that message again tonight, but just remember that as God forgives us, those who have been forgiven should be the first and fastest to forgive others when they do harm to us. And so that should be our plea. Sometimes we have to pray that forgiveness every day. It's an act of faith to say, God, I forgive them. And one of my favorite prayers in all the Bible, Lord, I believe, help me my unbelief. And I have many times prayed, Lord, I forgive them, help me my unforgiveness. Lord, I want to forgive them, God. And it's a daily thing. It's a battle. It's a process. But it's a process we need to be part of. Now, that's what we talked about last week, provision, absolution. Let's look tonight at these last two pleas of the disciple, the plea for direction and the plea for protection. We talked about faith in tension last week. Let's talk about faith in conflicts. Now, I want you to see this verse in the original language because the wording in English seems a little strange to us. Why would we need to pray, Father, lead us not into temptation? That seems an odd thing to pray. And so let me show you what some of these Greek words, I'm not going to try to pronounce them, but the word lead here in Greek, it means to bring or carry into something. Into union with something. The word temptation is an interesting word in Greek, and it really is defined by the context. It can mean temptation to sin, but it can also, in context, simply mean a trial, a testing. You will probably remember some of the times in school when you had to take a test or a quiz, and all the studying that you did or should have done, and all the stress that that brought on you when you felt unprepared for a test. Not all tests, not all temptations are negative, are bad things, but they can be bad things, as we'll see in just a moment. So, Father, don't carry us into union with trials, but rather, or instead, deliver us from evil. The word deliver here means to draw to oneself, to rescue. And from is apo, from which we get a number of different words, one of them being apostle, to be sent out, to move away from is what the little Greek word means, to be separated from. And the word evil is very interesting. I want you to see this as well. It literally comes from the Greek word for pain. Evil is what causes pain. I used the word, I think, wicked or evil today, and Elijah said, "What does that mean?" And I said, "Well, it's something that makes that hurts God's feelings, makes God angry." Trying to explain evil without being too descriptive to a five-year-old, but this is pain in the sense of there's a source of that pain. There's somebody bringing that pain into our lives, and so the picture of here is of being picked up from one thing and delivered unto something else. I don't know if you've ever had the experience where your child was about to step on something very painful or step into something very painful, or you happened to see a snake in the grass that was near your child and you grabbed that child and you didn't just move them away, you picked them up and brought them into your arms. You brought them into your arms. When Jesus says to pray for deliverance from evil, he's not just saying, ask God to get you a ticket out. He's saying, ask the Father to draw you close to himself so that you will be away from the one who causes pain, the evil one, who we would call the devil. And so my Ritchie's literal translation here, my paraphrase based on the meaning in the Greek of these words, Father, do not carry us into union with temptation. Instead, draw us to yourself and away from the evil one who causes us pain. Doesn't James say, draw near to God and he will draw near to you? There are times when we want to embrace our kids, we want to spend time with our kids, and they don't want any of it for whatever reason. They're too busy about their own thing, or they're in those early teen years, right? And they want to set their own boundaries, and they want to set their own identity, and they don't want, it's not as fun to spend time with mom and dad anymore. Jesus says we never, ever get to a point spiritually where we don't need our Heavenly Father anymore. We always need to be calling out to him to draw us near to himself. So let's talk about direction and protection for a minute. What does it mean to ask God for direction? Well, really what Jesus is saying is you need to pray for the wisdom to avoid bad choices. Lead us not into union with temptation. Pray for the wisdom to avoid bad choices. Now, understand this. Everyone faces trials. Trials are part of life. Everyone faces temptations. Temptations are part of life. It is not a sin to be tempted. It is human to be tempted. You live in a minefield. You are going to face temptation. Even Jesus was tempted, yet without sin. That's why he's able to be our high priest. By the way, I quote Hebrews 4:16 often, but let me remind you what Hebrews 4:15 says. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore, based on that reality, based on the fact that Jesus experienced temptation, based on the fact that Jesus experienced trials, let us therefore come boldly under the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Paul reminds us in 1 Corinthians 10, there hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man, but God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation always also make a way to escape that ye may be able to bear it. So there are trials. There are temptations. They are inevitable. They are part of life. But what we are to ask God for is not to be excluded from what Jesus was not excluded from, but to ask God in those trials, in those temptations, to show us the way out, to give us wisdom. Keep a finger in Matthew chapter 6 and go with me to James. James chapter 1. I know you know these verses, but I want you to see them again. If you don't have them underlined, I'd encourage you to underline them. Do some marking up of your Bibles. James says, my brothers, verse 2 of chapter 1, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations or diverse trials, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire or mature, wanting nothing. Well, how do I get through this trial then? Verse 5, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given to him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So James says there are good trials, and when we face those trials, we need to ask God for wisdom. But notice also that there are bad trials. Look at verse 13 of James chapter 1. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Do not err, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. So, trials are unavoidable. Ask God to show you the way through them. Temptations, though, need to be resisted, need to be run from. Flee youthful lusts that war against the soul. And here's the critical thing we need to understand. A trial can become a temptation to sin. It becomes a temptation to doubt God. It becomes a temptation to rely on ourselves. It becomes a temptation to get angry with God. God, why did you allow this to happen? Why didn't you stop this? God, why am I suffering the way that I'm suffering? And if we're not careful, the trial leads us into sin. Understand that trials can be temptations to surrender to sin, but when we surrender to sin, that always creates trials. There is no sin that does not create trial. That's what James just tells us. Listen, you give in to sin. Listen, it's not a sin to be tempted. But when you feed that temptation, it is going to grow. And it's going to lead to sin. And you're going to find yourself with all kinds of problems. And those problems don't always show up immediately, do they? Sometimes they show up like the credit card bill a month later. And I forgot I bought that. I forgot I spent that. And all of a sudden, you have to begin to pay the price for the indulgence. And sin is like that many times. Sometimes we don't get the bill until months later, sometimes not till years later. But make no mistake, be not deceived. God cannot be mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. And so we need to spend time on our faces before the Father, asking God to get us through the trials, to give us wisdom to get out, to show us the way of escape when we're tempted, and not to allow us to get into union with those things, to make them our lifestyle. Some people, it's like they just look for trial. They just look for trouble. Are you praying for the wisdom to get out, to get through? You can ask God not to give you any, but he's already told you he's going to. You can ask God to keep you from all temptation, but he's already told you, I'm not taking you out of the world yet. I'm praying that you'll be safe in the world. God has given us a mission to take the gospel to people, and that's going to lead to trials and temptations. So we need to make sure we're praying for the wisdom to get through them. We must pray for wisdom. And notice the second point. We must pray for the protection that only God's wisdom affords and only God's strength provides. Jesus said in Matthew 26, he was in the garden praying for you, praying for me, and his disciples couldn't stay awake. I can relate to that. I don't know how many times I've fallen asleep in prayer. Shame on me. The disciples were there to pray with Jesus. They couldn't stay awake. And what did Jesus say to them? Knowing what they were going to face. See, I don't know what I'm going to face tomorrow, but Jesus knows. And he says, you better be watching and praying. Jesus said to the disciples, watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And so we don't want trials to become temptations to sin. That's why we need to be praying. Lead us not into union with temptation. Don't let us get so comfortable in the trial that it leads us to temptation. Ask God to give you wisdom. Ask God to give you strength. Because as I shared with you this morning, Proverbs 14:12, Proverbs 16:25, there's a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. I think I know how to get through this myself. I don't need to spend time in prayer. I got this. I've dealt with this before. I don't need to spend time on my face asking God to give me wisdom to how to get out of this trial, how to get out of this difficult situation. I can do this. I can white knuckle this and get through. And then the trial becomes temptation and we enter into union with it and we fall asleep at the wheel like the disciples did. C.S. Lewis said this, we must learn by experience to avoid either trains of thought or social situations which for us, not necessarily for everyone, lead to temptations, like motoring. Don't wait till the last moment before you put on the brakes. But put them on gently and quietly while the danger is still a good way off. Now, sometimes the danger comes on you real quick. And it happened to Gigi and Elijah and I just a few days ago. I was kind of trying to get through a yellow light, but it was yellow. It was not red yet. And I was on my way to get through that yellow light. Well, guess what? Somebody else was barreling through the red light. And praise the Lord, we didn't get hit, because that would have been a very, very bad day. God protected us. Sometimes you don't see it coming. You got to slam on those brakes. But if you've ever been in somebody who's in the car with somebody who's just learning to drive, and they're slamming on the brakes, and they're waiting till the last second, you don't want to live your life like that. You don't want to live your life like that. So when you see it coming, and you need to know, and we know this by prayer, as the Holy Spirit's going to be tapping you on the shoulder, the Holy Spirit's going to be speaking to you and leading you, you know when you get in this situation that it leads to temptation. So just avoid it. Just avoid it. We don't even have cable anymore, but even before I got married, I learned
to turn the TV off at 10 o'clock. I just turned it off. I didn't watch it anymore. Don't want to deal with the commercials that were coming on. I don't know what kind of commercials are on now because, you know, don't have cable anymore. But we still have Hulu Plus, but pretty much we just use it for news and when we use it at all. But you just have to find what is your weakness, and you have to stay away from it. And part of that is praying through it, asking God to give you wisdom, asking God to give you strength. Friend, wisdom and power are provided to you, but they're not imposed on you. God says, here's my wisdom. Here's my wisdom. God says, if you're my child, you have the spirit of adoption inside of you. You have all the power you ever need. You have all the power you ever need because you have the very person of God living inside of you. We sang this song today. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave lives in us, in the person of the Holy Spirit. But listen, he's not going to impose his strength on you. You are not a robot. You are not a program. He gives you choices. He gives you responsibilities. And you have to lean on him. You have to call on him. We need to ask God to show us when we need to make changes, to give us wisdom, and we need to remember to rely on his power, to rely on his strength, the strength that he's already given to us. His divine power has already given unto us everything we need for life and godliness, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. But we only experience that, Peter says, through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these he has given us his exceedingly great and precious promises so that through them you might participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by sinful desires. Peter says, you want to tap into the power that lives inside of you? You better get into this book. You better learn what God's promises are, and you better ask the Holy Spirit to give you a deeper knowledge of who your Father is and who your Savior is. And the Holy Spirit will give you that knowledge, and through that knowledge, you'll experience the power of God in your life, and you'll find that things that used to break you don't break you anymore. Because it's not your strength anymore, it's his strength at work in you. Pray for God's direction, and of course, we need that strength because we need protection. We need protection. You have an enemy. You have an enemy. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And if you don't live in that reality, you are not going to understand a fraction of the things that you encounter in your life. The trials, the tribulations, you have an enemy. And he is thousands of years old, and he has been doing this for a very long time to great effectiveness. And if you don't believe me, you're not watching the news, because he is the one behind all that's going on. So we need to make sure that we are seeking God's protection. So we ask God for wisdom, but it's not, God, give me wisdom so that I can do this without you. Pray for proximity protection. Pray for proximity protection. Again, let me remind you what the verse says in the original language. Father, draw us to yourself. Deliver us means to draw us to yourself. It doesn't mean that, God, the danger is here, so pick me up and then take me over here and let me do my own thing. It's pick me up and hold me through this. Carry me through this. Draw me closer to you so that I will be free from the reach of the one who causes pain. Your adversary, the devil, governs the course of this world. We saw that in Ephesians chapter 2. We're going to dive into that, Lord willing. When we get into Ephesians chapter 6, we're going to look at that much more in depth. But the course of this world, the way the world works, is orchestrated by the devil. And he has set up a master plan of using media to entice and to discourage and to frustrate and to cause you to doubt And he's got his claws in the education system, and he's got his claws in governments of the world, and he's got his claws in everything. So you had better understand what we are up against. He has schemes set against you. He has traps set for you. Ephesians chapter 4 says, "Be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath, neither give place to the devil." If you are somebody who likes to be angry, because, and I used to, praise God, he's delivered me from this, but I used to have a bad temper. Now I hid it. I hid it from people. Because I got in trouble when I was in elementary. I got sent to the principal's office because of my temper. Because I got mad and I flipped over a desk in my classroom. I had a temper. And so I learned to hide my temper. And so when I was alone, I would throw things up against the wall and break things. And praise God, he delivered me from that. But you understand, you have anger in your heart, you have no self-control, that you're giving place to the devil. You are inviting the devil into your mind and into your plans and into your day. Listen to what Paul says in 2 Corinthians. "To whom ye forgive anything, I forgive also. For if I forgave anything, to whom I forgave it, for your sakes forgave it I in the person of Christ." Why is Paul such a forgiving person? Lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. See, this is why forgiveness is so important to Jesus. This is why forgiveness is so important to God. It's why he says, if you don't deal with forgiveness between one another, then we got a problem. You got a problem with Dad. If you can't forgive your sister, your brother, you have a problem with Dad. Because when we have unforgiveness, we are setting up a campsite for Satan in our life, for Satan in our family, for Satan in our church. And so we have to make sure that we are aware of how Satan gets in and how he works against us. So what do we do? Well, remember what Jesus prayed. Again, we're in the Garden of Gethsemane, John chapter 17, verse 15. Jesus is praying for you. And Jesus says, "I pray not that thou shouldst take them out of the world, but that thou shouldst keep them from the evil," or from the evil one. See, Jesus prayed for you, and God heard, the Father heard. And he now has given us the Spirit, and because of the work of the Holy Spirit, because of the victory of Jesus Christ, now victory for you is possible. He's not going to impose it. Not yet, but it is possible to have victory in Jesus. And so let me share this with you. Watchful prayers disarm Satan's snares. Watchful prayers disarm Satan's snares. Now, when I was a kid, I loved to play with army men. But the army men I didn't like were the minefield guys, right? Like, I don't want the minefield guy. I want to play, you know, give me the guy with the bazooka, right? Give me the guy with the flamethrower, the M16. I don't want to play with the mine detector guy. But you understand that the mine detector guy is one of the most important army men. Because he's the one that clears the field. And when we are praying for wisdom and for strength, and when we are praying that God will draw us close to himself and that we will have that father-child relationship, what you're going to see is those minds get disarmed. And that mind that you almost stepped on, suddenly it's not going to blow up in your face anymore. But see, you have to submit to God in prayer. You have to daily declare your dependence on him. You have to seek him as your Father, to get up in his arms. "Father, draw me to yourself and away from the one who causes me pain." And he will do it. And we pray with faith in Christ's authority and power. We pray in faith that he will deliver us. This is the confidence that we have in him. 1 John chapter 5, if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, we know that we have the thing that we've asked for. So we know that God wants us to draw near to him. We know that God wants us to cleanse our hands and to purify our hearts. We have that as a guarantee that if we come to him and ask for that cleansing and ask for that closeness, if we draw near to him, he will draw near to us. That's a promise that God has given us. And when we do that, he draws us away from the power of the one who causes us pain. But when we don't, oh, we're going to experience some pain that we could have avoided if we had prayed watchful prayers. Watchful prayers disarm Satan's snares. Now, I want to very quickly close with the doxology. Look at verse 13 again of Matthew chapter 6. Don't let us, God, come into union with temptation, but draw us away from the one who causes pain. Draw us to yourself. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now again, this isn't just something that we quote. What is Jesus saying here when he talks about our attitude and our approach to God and our statements of faith when we're praying to God? Why do we go to him as our Father? Why do we trust in Christ as our victorious Savior? Why do we depend on the Holy Spirit in prayer? Because Yahweh has supreme authority to rule. Thine is the kingdom. We are running out of time to reach people with the gospel. You understand that? We are running out of time. I'm not setting a date. I'm not saying Jesus is coming back tomorrow, although he certainly could. He could come back tonight. He is coming back soon, though. I can tell you that. And behold, he says, I come quickly. I come suddenly. I'm going to come as a thief in the night. You better be ready. And ultimately then, Revelation chapter 19, one of my favorite chapters in all the Bible, he's coming back with his bride to set up his kingdom on earth. His kingdom is coming. And the kings of the earth, they can rage all they want. Why do the nations rage and the kings plot a vain thing? Don't they know? The end is written. It is written. It is coming. And so when I pray, I need to remember Jesus is returning, and that return needs to motivate my service. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, an incredible chapter of the Bible talking about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But Paul ends it by reminding us in verse 58. You guys need to be steadfast and unmovable. You guys need to take the hope that we have, and it needs to change how you live today. Yahweh is the supreme authority to rule. Yahweh has the absolute ability to rule. Not only is his the kingdom, his is the power. He's not a puppet president. He is the powerful, all-powerful King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And there will be no question as to who's making the decisions and whose responsibility the decisions are in the kingdom of God. He is the one who has the absolute ability to rule, and his power through the Holy Spirit, Christ in you, the hope of glory, gives you the ability to serve. He empowers us. The Spirit empowers our service, and we need to pray like that. I'm not praying to get the power. I'm praying to have faith in the power he's already given me. Not by might, nor by our power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. Yahweh has the authority to rule. Yahweh has the ability to rule. Yahweh has the unique adequacy to rule. He doesn't just have the authority and the ability. He has the adequacy. He deserves it. He deserves it. He has earned the right. As if creating us was not enough. He bought us with his own blood. He came on the cross. He died on the cross. He shed his blood to pay for our sins. He rose again victorious over sin, over death, over the grave. He has the adequacy to rule. He has the right to rule. We can trust his heart because of how he has shown his heart to us. Only Yahweh is worthy of our worship. Andy's going to come and sing a song for us as we close. We're going to do the invitation just a little bit differently tonight. Just going to ask you to remain seated, to listen to the words of this song, which contain the words of this prayer. But if you have a need, the altar is open. Our deacons will be here at the front if you need to pray with somebody. If you just need to pray at the altar is open. But would you meditate on this prayer as we close in song?
It's hard to tell you just what you mean to us, Most Holy Father, hallowed be your name. You are the one we love. You are the one we trust. Most Holy Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Most Holy Father, hallowed be your name. You give us our daily bread. You keep hungry spirits fed. Most Holy Father, hallowed be your name. You give us the strength to live, to pardon as you forgive. Most Holy Father, hallowed be your name. When temptations come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Most Holy Father, hallowed be your name. We come to the mercy seat. We cast our crowns at your feet. Most Holy Father, hallowed be your name. Your people you will defend. Your reign of love never ends. Most Holy Father, hallowed be your name. When trials come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Most Holy Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven, most holy Father, hallowed be your name.
Father, what a privilege it is to be called your children. And Father, we thank you so much for the gift of your only begotten Son. God, it's through him that we're able to call you Father. It's by your Spirit, of the Spirit of adoption, that we're able to call you our Father. And so, God, thank you for the hope that we have. Thank you, God, for the victory that we have. And God, help us to be men and women who are faithful in prayer. Help us to see our need for prayer. Help us to see, God, that you have provided the way of prayer, the means of prayer. And God, help us as we apply these commands to our life, God, to see you move through our prayers, to unite us together, to make us one, and God, to see you do great and mighty things for your glory and for your kingdom. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Lord willing, we'll see you on Wednesday night, 6:30. You are dismissed.